Recording.
Okay, so in the last two sessions, we introduced the notion of module categories and of module functor. So today we will provide example of module categories, the basic example of module categories and bimodule categories. And in fact, most of the today's session will be about providing examples. If we have time, we will also start to discuss about exact module categories. It's a module category with some extra assumption making the classification more manageable. So, example of module categories. So this example will be not surprising. In fact, we will consider all the tensor category we already mentioned before, and we will see what are the natural module category on them. So the first example is a categorification of the notion of regular representation. So it will see that a multi-tensor category is a C-module category on itself. The module category in itself. So a multi-tensor category C is itself a C module category. Where the module product is just the tensor product, and the module associativity constraint is equal to the associativity constraint. Constraint on the of C itself. As I said, it is a categorification of the notion of regular representation. Notion of regular representation. So, regular representation in group theory is you take, you represent the group on itself or on the algebra generated by itself. Basically, if you have a GE group, then the regular representation is just the action given by the action on this. This is called the regular representation. This action provides a representation which is called the regular representation. And so what we said before is just generalization, a categorification of this notion. The category is a module on itself. Okay. So you can provide an obvious generalization of that instead of taking C module on itself, you can take C module on on the subcategory of itself. If D is a multi tensor subcategory, then C is D module category. So this what this example was. This is a straightforward example. Another example. So something we define, we already mentioned before. C is a C de ligne tensor product C op module category. With X tensor Y, so sorry, yeah, X tensor Y, module product Z to be X tensor Z tensor Y. And we will see that this is related to bimodule. Maybe more convenient to see that as a bimodule. So this is the line tensor product. And hop, let me. This is what we already recall recently. As for C, but you change the tensor product like that. Okay. So you can write the details in exercise if you want. The details of that to be a module C de ligne tensor product C hop module category with this module product. Okay. So as I said, this way to use the ligne tensor product and hop is more or less equivalent to consider a bimodule category. So more generally, let C D be multi-tensor category. And let M to be a CD bimodule category. Be a CD bimodule. I wrote more generally because what I wrote just before, it's you just take C equal D. Here you can take C D different in general. So then it is a C de ligne tensor product D op module category. And reciprocally. And reciprocally mean and reciprocally here mean that if you start from a C the tensor product D op module category, then you get a C D by module category. So these two are more or less the same notion. Okay. So exercise. Let M be a C D by module category. Show that M dual. So M dual. So this module category. So we already discussed that before. You just reverse the arrow, and we discussed maybe last session or the session before the connection between this and taking right, left, right adjoint, etc. Left and right module, yeah, according to that. Anyway, so this is a. So you show that the M dual is a DC module by module category. Okay. Now we will provide an example involving the canonical decomposition of a multi-tensor category. So do you remember that? When we introduce the notion of multi-tensor category, we saw that there is a kind of matrix-like structure in a multi-tensor category. You have this component, and the diagonal of the component are tensor category. So I will not recall the definition, but we did that in some previous session. So let C be a multi-tensor category. Let C, so IJC be its usual decomposition. every indecomposable, recall that every indecomposable object belongs to some CIJ. We call that. Okay, then, as you can expect, maybe Cij is a, so as I said, the diagonal, so I may recall that also. CII is a tensor category. But CIJ for I different from J is not a monoidal category, but it's a module. And it's also a bimodule. So it's a CIJ is a CII CJJ bimodule. Okay. So now the idea of the coming example is to answer some natural question. So you start from what you already know. For example, when is the trivial category VEC a C-module category? What about the VEC G module category or the RED G module category, etc. So the rest of the example will be of this will answer such natural question. So we will not always provide all the details of the proof of the classification of such example. Okay, so next example, want to answer the question, when is M equal VEC a C module category? So remember that we have this representation proposition we proved before, that a C module category is given by a tensor functor to to AND M. But here M is VEC, and in fact it's an exercise show that, but maybe it's not so trivial. AND M equal to VEC also. So M is VEC, but AND M is also equivalent to the category VEC as a tensor category. So in the book, they just write that AND M is equal to VEC or equivalent to VEC. But I read in the comment of Ulrich Thiel that it was not satisfied by this. It was that require more details. So you can see that as an exercise to show that they are the same, but we will assume that they are the same or they are equivalent as a tensor category. And that will be very useful to apply the representation proposition characterizing the C module category. So by previous representation proposition, VEC is a C module category if and only if there exists a tensor functor from C to AND M, the tensor functor. So, in other words, AND M is VEC, and so a tensor functor from C to VEC is a fiber functor. Fiber functor. So conclusion about this example. VEC has a structure of C module category if and only if C has a fiber functor, if and only if C has a fiber functor, So in that sense, the theory of module category generalized is the theory of hyperfunctor. The theory of module category is an extension of theory fiber functors. Okay. So that's good. So now exercise. So what is exercise about? So you take exercise. Let F from C to D be a tensor functor. So as I said, the representation proposition characterizes the module category using a tensor functor from C to some and M. But if you start from some tensor functor into some category, multi-tensor category D, then you can still get a module module category by considering the module product given by the left tensor product. So you take this, consider a tensor functor, then you can show that M called D has a structure of C module category with module product like that. So you just take you use the tensor functor. In fact, we know that this operation correspond to which operation I'm talking about. This can be seen as an element of AND D. So this is anyway. Okay. So now we saw example with what we can say about module category for M equal VEC. Now we will see what we can say about rep G module category. So you start from C equal rep G, and the question is, what are all the rep G module category? So let G be a finite group So what about Repti module catégorie. OK. So we will see that the repg module category are at least the semi-simple indecomposable repg module category are parameterized by two ingredients. One is a subgroup of G, and the other is a sum two co-cycle of this subgroup. But let us provide the easiest way to make a repg module category from a subgroup first. So let L in G be a subgroup. So the restriction from so this functor from rep G to rep L is a tensor functor. And so you can apply the previous exercise, the tensor functor, by this exercise. Here, you have a tensor functor, so you have a module category. So by previous exercise, rep L is a rep G module category, but as I said, we can provide much more general a series of RepG module category using a second parameter, which is a two co-cycle of this subgroup. More generally, let me mention that we cannot classify all, so it's very hard to classify all the RepG module category. We will see in the next session, but if we are interested in classification, we should restrict to module category with an additional assumption called exact, which is related to a projective object or something like that. In particular, if you are interested only in the semi-simple word, we can classify the semi-simple module category a priori general. But if you don't make assumption like semi-simple or exact, and it can be very, very hard or not reachable to classify all the module category, even for if you take the multi-tensor category to be just VEC, you can see easily that all the VEC module category are it's a huge, huge class of category. Okay, so more generally, so we may prove later. So I don't know if I will prove that in detail or not later, that every semi-simple indecomposable rep G module category is of the form rep phi L, where L where L in G is a subgroup as above. And phi is a cocycle. Phi in zi tu L Q a star. So the field without zero is a two cocycle called Schur multiplier. So I will provide a bit more details. In fact, this Schur multiplier is what you need to define a projective representation of the group L. If you have your usual representation, okay, but if you want a projective representation, you have a multiplicative constant given by the Schur multiplier. I will explain. Schur multiplier. So as I said, required to define a projective representation of L on some vector space. So projective representation from L on this vector space, and it's a projective representation. So you have this is not just that, but you have some multiplicative constant, and here is given by the Schur multiplier. So the Schur multiplier does not define a single projective representation, but if you fix a Schur multiplier, you can have a class of projective representation called, denoted like that. This is a class of projective representation parameterized for having this Schur multiplier, phi as a Schur multiplier. And any projective representation should have some multiplicative constant here. And so it's just a way to write all the class of projective representation with this given by phi, this multiplicative constant given by these two cosine. Okay. And every projective representation is of this form. So rep phi L is an abelian rep phi L is the abelian category of projective representation of the subgroup L with Schur multiplier phi. And let time is it? Okay. So there is another way to write this this category. So rep phi L is equal to the category of representation of the algebra KL twisted by phi, where KL phi is given by G H equal phi G H G H. Okay. Hmm. Okay, so now we saw about rep G module category. Now what about vec G module category? And we will see it's quite similar for some good reason related to the Grenfell Center. Rep G and vec G are Morita equivalent. They have the same Grenfell Center. And thanks to that, their module category are very similar. So what about now? What about VEC-G module category? Module category. So let me summarize. I will not go into too much details. So they are abelian category M. with such that, so with so collection of auto equivalence. So again, by previous representation proposition using AND M. So a collection of auto-equivalence F G from M to M, M map to like a collection. So any VEC G module category structure on M is given by that collection of by the this representation proposition, the collection of tensor functor isomorphism H. And two cocycle relation for the associativity GHK composed with GH equal GHK composed eta HK. So these two cocycle as relation as so for natural isomorphism FG compose FH compose FK, so associativity FGHK. For associativity, associativity. Okay. So I was a bit confused, a bit quick here, but the main point is the following, is that all these ingredients, we already mentioned that before, this is the ingredient for action action of a group. C'est un abélienne category with an action of G. So a VecG module category is the same thing as an abelian category with an action of G. So in other words, according to some previous session, we saw that before. A VecG module category is the same thing as an abelian category with an action of the group. Of the group G. Okay, so in some previous session, we define the notion of an action of the group G on an abelian category. And in fact, this was exactly this ingredient here. So a VecG module category is the same thing as an abelian category with an action of G. Okay. Now, as for FG, we can generalize this using some co-cycle. And in fact, So let So what did I say here? VecG module category, main category. So for VecG module category, we did not introduce the subgroup yet, but here, so in this proposition, we will see that any indecomposable semisimple VecG module category M is determined by the subgroup of G and some cocycle. So let us. So I will state that without proof. State without proof. The following classification result. Oh, it's time for the pause. So I will state that after the pause. Okay. Okay. So let me state this classification proposition. Proposition about indecomposable semi-simple VecG module category. Every indecomposable semi-simple VecG module category M is determined by A subgroup L in G such that the simple object of M correspond to this quotient. So the simple object of two equivalents are parameterized by this quotient. And you see that if L is not a normal subgroup, this quotient is not a group. and a two cocycle. In fact, we take an element of the cohomology group here, an element of H2, L. So recall that H2 is Z2, quotiented by B2. So it's a class of the class of two cocycles. Encoding. So this two cocycle encoding the VecG module associativity constraint. Associativity constraint. Okay. And such a module category M is denoted ML phi. So let me remark what I said before about the similarity between RepG module category and VecG module category. Remark indecomposable semi-simple. Semi-simple. Module category over RepG is given by RepFiG over VecG. This is what we just called ML phi, the RepL phi L, sorry. So you have the same two parameters with L a subgroup and phi a two cocycle or a class of two cocycles. And as I said, this similarity is related to the fact that they are Morita equivalent. This similarity should be explained We may see that later, but that's why I write should, because I did not read in details the chapter concerning that. Should be explained by the fact that vec g and rep g, so this is really fundamental result, are Morita equivalent. So I will not define that now. This is one of the goals of this course, to be more comfortable with Morita equivalence and Grünfeld center. Or equivalently, have same Grünfeld center. This is also a result, famous result, that for spherical fusion category, to be Morita equivalent is the same as to have the same Grünfeld center. But we will see that later. This is the part of the course I am very interested in. We'll see that later. Then we'll have a full chapter dedicated, full section dedicated to this point. Okay. So that's all for the list of basic examples. Now we will introduce a subclass of module category called the exact module category, allowing more manageable classification. So I will introduce this new notion of exact module category by motivation. So exact module category over finite tensor category. Okay. So as I said, the understanding of all the module category over a finite tensor category, sorry, may be too complicated to classify, even if you take the tensor category to be trivial, to be vague, because then this classification requires to understand all the k-linear locally finite abelian categories. That's why we need an additional assumption to make such a classification more manageable. And this additional assumption is called exact. And it is related to projective object. So let me write that introductive sentence, and then the definition of what is an exact module category. So the understanding of all the module category over a finite tensor category may be too complicated. Complicated. Even for C equal vec, where it requires. That's why in the previous section we classified, we stated the classification in the semi-simple case. And the semi-simple implies exact. In fact, so it requires the understanding of all the k linear locally finite abelian category, which is unmanageable. The following definition make classification much more manageable. The definition. So let C be a multi-tensor category with enough, so I will recall that with enough projective objects, we saw that the first session, but you may forget, that enough projective object, which mean every simple object has a projective cover. Every simple object has a projective cover. So the in this course, I want to cover the proof, except for that what is trivial in the semi-simple case. If you have some result which are trivial in the semi-simple case, or result which are in some sense purely non-semi-simple interest, that I don't cover the proof. And as I said in the chapter about of algebra, I don't cover the proof also of the result which are about of algebra. But otherwise, my goal is to cover proof. So in this section will be about definition of example of exact one category. But the next section will be about some properties of exact module category, and I will not cover the proof because this is only non-trivial for the non-semi-simple case. And for now, I am mainly interested in the semi-simple case. So I don't want to take too much time for the non-semi-simple case, but I still state the result without proof. Okay. So the non-semi-simple world, you have to deal with projective objects, etc. So the notion of exact module category, it's a generalization of the notion of semi-simple module category. So C module category is called exact if for all p in for all object p for all projective object and for all object in the module M, then the module product of P by NM is also projective in M. And let me recall also, that X in some category, abelian category D, is projective if, by definition, the Ohm set P, this functor given by induced by the Ohm set is an exact is a exact functor. This functor is exact. And here, exact means that it keeps the exactness of the short exact sequence. So it keeps the short exact sequence. You apply the functor, you still have the short exact sequence. Okay. Okay. So here we saw that to have an exact C module category, you take a projective object in C and an object in M, and you make the module product of P and M. And this is also projective. But if you take a projective object here and a general object here, the next exercise says that in general, without assuming exact, this is always projective. So, exercise show that if M is a C-module category, C-module category without assuming exact. X is an object of C, Q is an object of M, a projective object of M, then X module product with Q is projective in M. Okay. So as I said, exactness here for module category, the generalization of semi-simple. Any semi-simple C module category is exact. Because every object is projective. If I remember properly, an abelian category is semi-simple if and only if every object is projective and injective. But maybe at least they are all projective. I don't know if it's the converse is true. I guess it is, if my memory is correct. Okay, so what about example of module category, exact module category? So remark, vec module category is exact if and only if it is semi-simple. So here there is no difference between exact and semi-simple. If C is trivial, so equal vec, then the exact vec module category are exactly the same thing as the semi-simple vec module category. Because one in vec is projective, so is M equal one module product M for all M in M. And more generally, you have some issues. If you take a semi-simple module category, exact is the same thing as being semi-simple. So that's why all these notions are mainly relevant for the non-semisimple case. Otherwise, it is the same thing as semisimple. C'est semi-simple, a C-module category is exact, if and if it is semi-simple. So, the introduction of this new notion exact is relevant in the non-semi-simple case. See, otherwise, it is the same as semi-simple for the module. So if it is the same as semi-simple, you don't need to introduce the new notion. Okay. That's why I will go quickly in the next section about the property for this, about this new notion. Similar category. No. In fact, what I am really interested in is next, the chapter, the section after that, which will be about algebra in multi-tensor category. In this section, I guess I will cover the proof, the section about algebra on the multi-tensor category. But for now, I will not. Okay, so what time is it? Mind 20 minutes. Yeah. So the next example say that a multi-tensor category is a C-module category on itself, that we already know, but it's also an exact, is exact as a C-module category on itself. So let's see, be a multi-tensor category. Px in C, with P projective object, then recall that P tensor X is also projective. So C is an exact C module category. And similarly, C is an exact C Deligne tensor product C op category, module category. Module category. OK. So now we will provide example of exact module, six module category induced by a surjective functor. A surjective tensor functor. So let me recall what is a surjective functor. Now recall that. So I change the color because in fact this recall is not the same thing as this recall. You should not. Yeah, this is two. This recall is just that. In a multi-tensor category, if you make the tensor product of the projective with something else, it's still projective. Now recall that. A functor f from C to D is surjective so we remove this color. So it's surjective if any simple object in D is a subquotient of some fx, x is an object of C. So I will not recall what is a subquotient. This is a quotient of a subobject or something like that. So if so it's, so this functor is surjective if any simple object in D is a subquotient of some f of x with x in C. And it should not be confused with another notion called essentially surjective. Okay. So now let us provide an example of exact C module induced by a surjective tensor functor. Example. Let C D be finite multi-tensor category. Categories. And let F from C to D be a surjective tensor functor. So we already know that from such a we already know that a tensor functor induce so C module category on D. But you with the surjective assumption, this C module category given by the tensor product as a module product is exact. So be a surjective. So the surjectivity provides the exactness. Surjective tensor category. tensor category. Then F induce a structure of exact C module category on D. And exact is for surjective and C module is for tensor given by the functor. With using that for a tensor module product. And exercise. So this exercise is to find an example of a non-surjective tensor functor providing a non-exact C module category D, which means that the surjectivity is really required to have exactness. We cannot prove exactness without surjectivity. This assumption is not superfluous. So find example with F non-surjective and D non-exact as C module category induced by F, which means surjective is not superfluous to get exact. Okay. Okay. So in the last 10 minutes, I will start to list some basic results about exact module category. I will list them without covering the proof, because as I said, this result are relevant only in the non-submissible case. First, properties of exact module category. Categories. Okay. So as I said, I should write another color because this is not. We will state the main result of this section without proof, because they are trivial in the semi-simple case. And for now, we are mainly interested in the semi-simple case. Maybe I will be interested in the non-semi-simple case in the future. Interested. But for now, not in the semi-simple case. And we do not want to take too much time for the non-semi-simple case. Okay. So let C be a mid-answer category. First statement. Assume that an exact C-module category M has finitely many isomorphism class of simple objects. So assume that an exact C-module category has finitely many simple objects up to isomorphism. Then this module category M is finite in the sense that we already mentioned before. The Homme set, Homme space are finite dimensional. Every object is of finite length, and there are enough projective objects and finitely many simple objects. So you have four axioms for being finite for abelian category. And in the this exactness case, we only need to check the last one. This is the point of this result. Assume that an exact C-module category M has finitely many simple object up to isomorphism, then M is finite so this is assumption four for finite to have finitely many simple objects. But let me recall the other one, as I said. One is Dimke of Homme M of AB finite dimensional for all AB, etc. So for all M in M, M is of finite length. So as this is related to Jordan order. The third proper axiom is to have enough projective. So I recall that recently today. And the fourth one is this one, finitely simple. So this statement say that if an abelian category has a structure of C module category, which is an exact also, then to be finite, you only need to check the fourth assumption. Then the fourth assumption implies all the other ones. Okay. So let me state a second resultant that will be enough for today. In an exact six module category, any projective object is injective. And vice versa, in other words, it's a quasi Frobenius category. When a projective are injective and injective are projective, this is what we call quasi Frobenius category. In an exact six module category, any projective. Any projective object is injective and vice versa. Vice versa means the other way also. Is injective and vice versa. In other words, which means that quasi, this is the definition of quasi Frobenius. Frobenius category. Okay. So I will stop here. So see you later. See you later. See you later.